Greetings to everybody. So this is the second lecture for the schizophrenia lecture series that we have started. As I said earlier, it would comprise of about 2 to 3 lectures, but I guess this is the second lecture and that's all about schizophrenia. So I'm Dr. Birwa Desai from Department of Psychiatry. I'd like to recapitulate what we did in the last lecture, just a very brief revision of it. So although schizophrenia is discussed as if it is a single disease, it probably comprises a group of disorders with heterogeneous etiologies, and it includes patients whose clinical presentations, treatment response and courses of illness vary, right? So yesterday I said it is a very chronic, complicated and complex and a serious psychiatric disorder, right? Signs and symptoms are variable and include changes in perception, emotion, cognition, thinking and behavior. Right? The expression of these manifestations varies across patients and over time, but the effect of the illness is always severe and is chronic, that is very long lasting. Now why I am trying to revise these aspects is that yesterday there was a different presentation, but today's presentation, this will be very useful to you if you have to write a short note on schizophrenia, right? In exams, if you have to write, this much of content will be more than enough for you people at your stage, okay? When you give your final MBBS written theory examinations and your medicine paper, as I said earlier, questions on psychiatry, a separate section on psychiatry is included, right? That is a very scoring section. Usually you can make up for the deficit in marks for the main medicine subject, okay? So, the disorder usually begins before the age of 25 years, persists throughout life and affects persons of all social classes. Both patients and their families often suffer from poor care and social ostracism because of widespread ignorance about the disorder. Schizophrenia is one of the most common of the serious mental disorders, but its essential nature remains to be clarified. Thus, it is sometimes referred to as a syndrome, as the group of schizophrenias, or as in the 5th edition of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, which is DSM-5, I told you about the classification of the psychiatric disorders, the International Classification System. This is mainly by the American Psychiatric Association, but then it is called the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual. And this is the 5th version. There have been earlier versions also. The current one is the 5th version. We call it DSM-5 in brief. Okay. Just a very little history about schizophrenia, which yesterday I did not, in the previous lecture I did not cover, which is Eugene Bleuler. He coined the term schizophrenia, which replaced the term dementia praecox. Previously, this disorder, the spectrum of this disorder used to be called dementia praecox. It's not dementia. Dementia is a separate medical condition, a psychiatric condition, a neuropsychiatric condition. It is a separate thing, but previously it was called dementia praecox. Eugene Bleuler was the one who gave the term schizophrenia. He chose the term to express the presence of schisms among thought, emotion, and behavior in patients with the disorder. He stressed that unlike Kraepelin's concept of dementia praecox, it is Kraepelin who gave the term dementia praecox. So unlike Kraepelin's concept, it need not have a deteriorating course. This term is often misconstrued, especially by lay people, to mean split personality. I started the previous lecture on that note. Split personality, it is a different thing. It is dissociative disorder. The best reference, the recent most reference, is Abhishek Bachchan in Breathe 2 season. I'm sorry for spoilers. Now, Bleuler also identified the 4 A's. Previously, schizophrenia was explained via these 4 A's. Which are the 4 A's? He identified specific fundamental or primary symptoms of schizophrenia to develop his theory about internal mental schisms of patients. These included associational disturbances of thought, associational disturbances, affective disturbances, autism, and ambivalence. These are the 4 A's: association, affect, autism, and ambivalence. You should remember, even if you prepare for your these postgraduate entrance examinations, this is a very, very, very important question. Okay, the 4 A's of Bleuler. He also identified accessory symptoms, which included the symptoms that Kraepelin saw as a major indicators of dementia praecox, that is, hallucinations and delusions. Just very briefly, this presentation has been made keeping in mind that how would you write a short note on schizophrenia? Okay, that is why I'm repeating these things. So epidemiology in brief, gender and age, prevalent more in men than women. Two genders, however, differ in the onset and the course, the progress of the disorder. It is the onset is earlier in men than in women. More than half of all the male schizophrenia patients, but only 1/3 of the female patients are first admitted to a psychiatric hospital before the age of 25 years. The peak ages of onset are 10 to 25 years for men and 25 to 35 for women. Women display a bimodal age distribution with a second peak occurring in middle age. So previously I gave example of a 70-year-old male coming with symptoms resembling that of schizophrenia. Would you call it schizophrenia? Less likely, because the age of onset is not very characteristic of schizophrenia. But in women, on the other hand, the age of onset is usually 25 to 35 years. But sometimes in some women, in middle age, there is this second peak, or the appearance of the symptoms also occurs in that age group, middle age. So approximately 3 to 10% of women with schizophrenia present with disease onset after the age of 40 years. Onset of schizophrenia before the age of 10 years or after 60 years is extremely rare. Reproductive factors, which play a role in the epidemiology, which are use of psychopharmacological drugs, open door policies in hospitals, deinstitutionalization in state hospitals, and the emphasis on rehabilitation and community-based care for patients. They have all led to an increase in the marriage and fertility rates among persons with schizophrenia. It is now feasible for patients with schizophrenia to do a job, to work, to earn for themselves, to manage themselves, and to carry a life like other normal individuals. The number of children born to parents with schizophrenia is continually increases. As I said, there is strong correlation with positive family history. So if these schizophrenic people, they are continuing their life forward, there are very high chances that their offsprings will also have an increased probability of getting schizophrenia. The first degree biological relatives of persons with schizophrenia have 10 times greater risk for developing the disease than the general population. Persons with schizophrenia, as far as the medical illness and epidemiology is concerned, they have a higher mortality rate from accidents and natural causes than general population. Institution or treatment related variables do not explain the increased mortality rate, but the higher rate may be due to the fact that the diagnosis and treatment of medical and surgical conditions in schizophrenia patients can be clinical challenges. Substance abuse, not just alcohol, but nicotine, cannabis, tobacco, opioids, cocaine, all kinds of substance use are associated with poorer function, and these substance abuses are commonly seen in patients with schizophrenia. Okay. Amphetamines, cocaine, and similar drugs should raise particular concern because of their marked ability to increase psychotic symptoms. Other factors that play a role in epidemiology of schizophrenia is infections, population density, and socioeconomic and cultural factors. The background, how the way they live, okay, the areas, the population density of the regions in which they live, the incidence and prevalence of infections. Okay. Now, etiology, genetic factors, as I said, there is a genetic contribution to some, perhaps all forms of schizophrenia, and a high proportion of the variance in the liability to schizophrenia is due to additive genetic effects. For example, schizophrenia and related disorders occur at an increased rate among the biological relatives, the first biological relatives. Okay. The likelihood of a person having schizophrenia is correlated with the closeness of the relationship to an affected relative, first or second degree. Biochemical factors we had gone through in detail, I'm just naming them. The dopamine hypothesis, serotonin, glutamate, GABA, gamma-aminobutyric acid, acetylcholine, neuropeptides. If you have done your pharmacology well, you will understand that all these are neurotransmitters. Okay. A question for you is, which of the neurotransmitters are excitatory? Which of the neurotransmitters are inhibitory in the brain? Okay. inhibitory or excitatory? Find them out. Okay, discuss it among your friends, maybe in your WhatsApp groups. These are the clinical features. I said positive symptoms, negative symptoms and cognitive deficits. Positive symptoms are the symptoms which are there but should not be there. Bin bulaye mehman. Negative symptoms, the symptoms that should be present but they are not there. Okay, those are the negative symptoms. Cognitive deficits are difficulty with memory, attention, planning or decision making. So the positive symptoms are hallucinations, delusions, disorganized thoughts. Negative symptoms include alogia. I had said the five A's: alogia, affective flattening, avolition, anhedonia, apathy. Apathy is not written here, but it is apathy. Okay. Now coming to prognosis. I think we have stopped at the diagnosis part in the previous lecture. So now we are continuing with prognosis. Several studies have shown that over the 5 to 10 year period after the first psychiatric hospitalization for schizophrenia, only about 10 to 20% of patients can be described as having good outcome. More than 50% of patients can be described as having a poor outcome, with repeated hospitalizations, exacerbations of symptoms, episodes of major mood disorders and suicide attempts. We had talked in detail about suicide in these patients, right? It could be because of the secondary depression, because they are having the illness, they can have secondary depression, they can sink into it and then attempt a suicide, or they could be having hallucinations which command them. Commanding hallucinations which tell them to go and jump off a building or commit suicide in any other way. Okay. Despite these glum figures, schizophrenia does not always run a deteriorating course and several factors have been associated with good prognosis. So why it is called a chronic, debilitating, disabling, complex disorder? Because the prognosis is not always very good. It's not that the patients completely recover, there is 100% recovery. The patients might recover, they might get functional, they might start working, they might start carrying out a normal, apparently normal life. But some residual symptoms, maybe some hallucinations or maybe a decreased socio-occupational functioning, okay, a decreased mental abilities, those residual symptoms might remain and that hampers the complete recovery in these patients, okay. There could be multiple episodes. Once a patient is schizophrenic, he might have multiple exacerbations repeatedly after 5 years, after 10 years, or maybe non-compliance of medications. Once they have started on medications, in most cases of schizophrenia, the medications last for almost a lifetime. Many a times what happens that because of stoppage of medication due to some reason, because nowadays we have seen a lot of patients that because of lockdown, they could not move out, they could not get the medication. So the patients were deprived of medications and hence the symptoms aggravated. Okay, this is one of the current scenarios, but then not medication stoppage is not the only reason, but then it is also one of the important reasons and one of the many reasons why exacerbation of symptoms might occur repeatedly. Diagnostic criteria for schizophrenia, it includes the criteria in the diagnosis, the DSM-5, as I said here, this is a mistake, it should be DSM-5, published by the American Psychiatric Association. Medical history is the key for diagnosis of schizophrenia, okay? A detailed medical history from the patient as well as the family members is very, very important. See, in any psychiatric disorders, history from family members is very important, because if the person is delusional about something, he's not going to tell you what delusion he is having. He's going to say, this is my belief, this is truth. The patient would come and say, I don't have anything. I just have occasional headaches. I don't have any problem. The patient is in total denial of his symptoms, right? So how are you going to diagnose that this patient has the symptoms? You have to tell the patient, could you please wait outside for a few minutes? I'll talk to your relative. So the history from the relative stands very, very important. Then you start asking the relative, what symptoms does the patient have? The relative would say, he's very suspicious. If we give him food, he would say that we have mixed some poison or something in the food. We want to harm him, we want to kill him by any means, and that everybody is constantly looking at him. Even if people are talking about some random things, the patient would feel that they are talking about me. He would have these referential ideas that somebody is talking about me, somebody is looking at me, there are CCTV cameras that are recording me all the time, right? So the patient is getting suspicious. Then sometimes the patient gets very angry. He gets angry, he gets assaultive, he starts hurling abuses. He uses very foul language. He does not take care of himself. There is no self-care whatsoever. The patient does not take a shower for days together. We have to repeatedly tell him to do so. The patient does not sleep at night. He wanders around. He roams around in the house. Sometimes he even goes out somewhere without informing any family members. We have to go looking for him and then catch hold of him and bring him home. Right? Sometimes we see that he's just sitting alone and doing something like this. Meaning talking to himself. He might be having hallucinations, he might be talking to the hallucinations, but then he is in his old world. The touch with reality has been affected to the extent that patient is in the world of his hallucinations. He is talking to the hallucinations, but we people feel that, why is he talking to himself? Why is he laughing at himself? Why is he crying by himself? Okay, so these history, of course the patient is not going to give this history. You take this history from the family members, the people who stay in close association with them, right? So in this manner, you get a detailed history about the clinical features, and then you ask, what is the duration of these symptoms, if I may ask? Then they would say, oh, it has been around five to six months. We noted some changes since around 1 to 2 years, but since the last 6 months, it has increased considerably. So you mention on your case paper, on your history sheet, you mention the symptoms are there from 1 to 2 years, increased since the past 5 to 6 months, right? So you've got delusions, hallucinations, disorganized behavior, right? Negative symptoms also, if the history goes like that, and the duration is satisfied more than 6 months. It is not due to the effect of any substances. That is one of the important criteria of the DSM-5. It is not due to the effect of any substance abuse whatsoever. Okay, so you meet the criteria and then you stamp the patient. It is schizophrenia. Okay, you give them the diagnosis. This is schizophrenia. You explain it to the relatives and then you start treatment for the same. Okay, so that is about the medical history. Then blood tests and imaging. CBC could be helpful to diagnose anemia, infections, a lot of other medical conditions. Radiological scans may be useful for the COVID-19, for an example, chest x-ray or HRCT. For meningitis maybe, or encephalitis maybe, CT scan is useful. For brain tumors, MRI is useful. For psychiatric disorders, these blood tests, they are not diagnostic. I'll tell you why we do these blood tests and imaging in cases of schizophrenia. It is helpful to monitor general health and rule out other conditions that may have been responsible for the symptoms. Right? That is a part of baseline evaluation. Plus, a blood test gives an idea about the hemodynamic status of the patient. Why we need to get an idea? Because we are going to start some medications that might have adverse effects, like decrease in the blood count, the total cell count, the WBC count in short. There are medications, for an example, clozapine, which can cause reduced WBC count. Okay, so before starting those medications, how do we know that the blood count, the total leukocyte count has decreased? We will get to know only if we have done a baseline evaluation, right? We do a baseline evaluation and then we start the medications and then we monitor as per the protocols. In some cases, certain imaging studies such as MRI or computed tomography, CT scan, may aid in the diagnosis. It has been written aid in the diagnosis. It is not a diagnostic test. Psychiatric evaluation, I have already talked about it. A doctor or mental health professional checks the mental status by observing appearance, demeanor, and asking about thoughts, moods, and awareness. Why appearance? If you have done clinical postings in any subject, they might have told you while teaching you basic history taking that the moment the patient enters in your room, since then you start observing him and formulating things in your head, right? A schizophrenic patient, he might be disheveled. Disheveled means hair are not combed, might be stinking because the patient might not have taken bath for, might not have taken shower for days together. Clothes are disorganized, very shabby clothes, okay? No personal hygiene, no self-care, okay? By those looks you can make out, okay, the patient is grossly disorganized, this sense of dressing up has been seriously compromised, so that gives you the appearance of the patient is, the self-care of the patient is compromised, and that gives you an idea that this is not any common psychiatric disorders like maybe depression or anxiety. It is a pointer towards psychotic spectrum, that is the schizophrenia spectrum disorder. Okay. A person may be diagnosed if they have at least two of the following symptoms, usually over a month. See, the criteria is that symptoms, all the syndromal symptoms, they should be for 6 months. But delusions, hallucinations, they should be present for at least 1 month of the 6 months. For at least 1 month, delusions and hallucinations should be present. Okay. Disorganized behavior, as in I told you, anger outbursts, assaultive outbursts, abusive, hurling abuses, using foul language. Okay. Disorganized speech. You ask them a question and they answer something, the answer is something totally different, unrelated to what your question was. Okay. The thought process is deranged because of distractions, maybe due to the hallucinations, or the core thought process itself, it is deranged. Okay. Catatonic behavior, maybe hypoactivity or hyperactivity. Negative symptoms, we have talked in detail about them already. Then prognosis. I said the prognosis usually is very poor. Okay. There is no known cure for schizophrenia. It's not that you give a medication and 1, 2, 3 within a 6 month course or maybe 1 year course, the patient will be cured. No. It is a chronic disorder. It will take lifetime medications. There is no known cure for it. Fortunately, there are effective treatments that can reduce the symptoms to the extent that the symptoms can be totally controlled also. There can be 100% improvement, but relapses, recurrences are very, very common. So the medications, they are pretty effective. I'll tell you, clinically also they are pretty effective. The hallucinations stop, the patient's thought process comes into order. Okay. They decrease the likelihood that new episodes of psychosis will occur, shorten the duration of psychotic episodes, and in general, offer the majority of people the possibility of living a more productive and satisfying life. With proper medications and supportive counseling, the ability of schizophrenic persons to live and function relatively well in society is excellent. Recoveries are possible. Okay. Hospitalization, you need to admit these patients. Why? Because they could be a threat to themselves, their own lives, as well as a threat to the family members. Because they are sometimes aggressive to such extent that they break things at home. They try to harm people, they try to attack them, assault them. In any possible ways. That is why you take them away from their family, you admit them in a setup, probably a mental health establishment. During crisis periods or times of severe symptoms, hospitalization may be necessary to ensure safety. Proper nutrition. Yeah, nutrition is also a very important factor, because they stop eating sometimes because of suspiciousness that they might have mixed something in the food. They might try to harm me by mixing something in the food. Okay. Adequate sleep and basic hygiene. Psychosocial interventions, individual therapy, that is psychotherapy. This is psychotherapy itself is a vast topic. You just need to memorize the names. You don't need to go into the details of it. So it may help to normalize the thought patterns. Also, learning to cope with stress and identify early warning signs of relapse can help people to manage their illness. Because what happens is, in the society, when a person is schizophrenic, the stigma is real. I repeat, the stigma with mental disorders is very real. The family members also sometimes abandon. Forget about the neighbors and the relatives and the friends, the distant friends and everybody. Family members themselves find it very difficult to cope up with it. To stay with a person with schizophrenia is very, very difficult. Okay. So once they recover, once they get an idea, once they get an insight that they have been suffering from this kind of illness, they suffer from a lot of stigma from other people. A lot of stigma. Once they realize that they have had this illness, they have harmed other people unknowingly, unintentionally, they might get secondary depression, post-psychotic depression we call it, but then to cope up with it becomes really difficult. okay, they might not get jobs. You show a certificate from a hospital or case papers from hospital showing that you have suffered from a mental illness, and people will, their outlook, their perception will completely change. They will, okay, yes, it is psychiatric illness. No, we don't want to keep them. आगे जाके क्या कर देंगे, क्या पता वापस तबियत बिगड़ गई तो क्या करेंगे, नहीं नहीं हम तो इसको काम पे नहीं रखेंगे. दिस इज जस्ट एन एग्जांपल, बट द स्टिग्मा इज वेरी वेरी रियल. टू कोप अप विद दैट बिकम्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट फॉर द पेशेंट, एंड दैट इज व्हाई द सपोर्टिव साइकोथेरेपी, इंडिविजुअल थेरेपी, ऑल दोज थिंग्स प्ले एन इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट. आफ्टर द एक्टिव हेल्यूसिनेशन एंड डिल्यूजनल प्रोसेस इज ट्रीटेड बाय मेडिकेशंस, दिस इज समथिंग वी रियली नीड टू लुक इनटू. वी नीड टू गिव देम रिहैबिलिटेशन. हाउ? What are they best at? In spite of their illness, in spite of the schizophrenic illness, taking in mind their educational status and their qualifications, what is the best job that they can do? What is the best task that they can perform? We have to teach them how can you live in spite of having a complicated disorder like schizophrenia, okay? So rehabilitation plays a very important part. We call it social skills training here. Social skills training. It focuses on improving communication, how they can communicate better, social interactions, and improving the ability to participate in day-to-day activities. Okay. Family therapy. This provides support and education to the patient families. We need to teach the family members. They are not doing intentionally. It is a part of their illness, just like other illnesses, like diabetes or hypertension or other autoimmune disorders and whatnot, everything that is there in your textbooks, just like that, this is also a disorder. Okay, you have to understand it is a disorder. What are the symptoms of the disorder? You should be alert if symptoms reappear. You should seek for help. You should seek for treatment, get them treated, and help them live a normal life. Like if a person has a disability, like if a person is handicapped, okay, lower limb surgery has been done or lower limb has been amputated. Entire family supports them, right? Unko uthne baithne se leke, using the washroom, sitting in a car, going to places, walking, you help them, right? In the same way, for this kind of a complex disorder, for schizophrenia also, you have to help them, you have to rehabilitate them in every possible way, starting from their homes to occupations and to the society in general. Vocational rehabilitation and supported employment. This focuses on helping people with schizophrenia prepare for, find, and keep jobs. You might have heard of some cafes who employ only deaf and mute people. Or there is a cafe in Mumbai which employs only the third gender people. Male, female, and the third gender. They employ only them. That is how, as a society, we can help them. There are people who make factories in which they give jobs to only people who have these kind of disabilities. Disabilities or different abilities, as they prefer to call it. You have to generate this kind of employments to help patients like these survive on their own, right? Because otherwise they have to be dependable on their families for their lives, which is again a very, very difficult aspect. Sometimes, you know, you might have seen some people, very disorganized look, baal wal khule and everything, roaming on the streets. You feel like they have nobody, in the same clothes. Every day you go through that street, you see that same person over there. He is just talking in the air, talking to himself, just roaming around, wandering around. You know, very bad condition. They have nobody. They might not have anybody in the family, or the family might have deserted them. They are just roaming around in the streets. These people, they most probably have very chronic schizophrenia, very long-standing disease. They are not in a good condition, right? They need to be taken care of. They need to be institutionalized. The mental hospitals, the government-owned mental hospitals, they are the relatives of family members of this disorder, they take them up and admit them to these institutions, and then they stay there for maybe lifetime in some cases, okay? Electroconvulsive therapy, ECT, the shock treatment, what we call it, is not like what they have shown in movies. They gag them and then hold them and compulsorily give them shocks. No, it's not like that. It resembles a minor operative procedure. Maybe you have some incision and drainage to be performed. I hope you know what is incision and drainage, IND. So there is some postural formed. You go under very short anesthesia, minor procedure. You go under anesthesia and perform the procedure, and within 5, 10 minutes, 15 minutes or half an hour, you are out of anesthesia and you are good to go. Similarly, short anesthesia is given, seizures are induced. Okay, short anesthesia is given. Seizures are induced by placing electrodes on it. There is a lot, ECT itself is a vast topic. There are books written on it, which is not necessary for you to know. But then seizures are induced. Okay, the patient has a seizure for around 40 seconds, maybe 1 minute. It stops on its own. And then the patient is brought out of the anesthesia, and that's all about it. Okay, it's nothing like what they show in movies or whatsoever. So the indication for ECT is mainly severe depression, the one with suicidal ideations. But schizophrenia also, it is one of the treatment of choice. Indications of ECT for schizophrenia are catatonic stupor, catatonia, uncontrolled, catatonia. Acute exacerbations not controlled with drugs, risk of suicide, homicide, or danger of physical assault. As I said, suicidal depression, that is one of the main indications of ECT. But then for schizophrenia also it is given in addition to the pharmacotherapy. Pharmacotherapy is the mainstay. Okay, ECT comes as a second line treatment. The clinical management includes the APA guidelines treatment recommendations for patients with schizophrenia, which are divided into three phases: acute phase, stabilization phase, stable phase. Acute phase is in the 4 to 8 weeks, defined by acute psychotic episode. Stabilization phase money constitutes a limited time, limited transition to continuing treatment. And then the stable phase, not very important. The pharmacotherapy, that is very important. I think you will have a separate section in your pharmacology subject in which this is also covered. The antipsychotic drugs, they are first generation, second generation, or typical antipsychotics, which are first generation, atypical antipsychotics, that are the second generation. These are all the names of it. This is the classification of first generation antipsychotics. Classification as per the chemical composition. Phenothiazine, this is a spelling mistake, I'm sorry about it. Phenothiazines, okay, with aliphatic side chain, piperidine side chain, piperazine side chain, butyrophenones, thiazanthines. This is again a spelling mistake. Thioxanthine and other heterocyclics. You can just rectify these names. Nobody can help you with pharmacology, okay. Second generation antipsychotics or atypical antipsychotics. These are the names. Again, rectify. Clozapine, olanzapine. Clozapine is a third choice in schizophrenia. If you feel that both first generation, second generation antipsychotics are not working, then you give clozapine. You remember I said the name of clozapine when I said it reduces WBC count? Yes. That's an important question for your PG preparation, entrance preparation. Olanzapine, quetiapine, aripiprazole, risperidone, amisulpride, ziprasidone. So when you are asked in Viva about second generation antipsychotics, you should not start with clozapine. Please remember this. Start with olanzapine, risperidone, quetiapine, aripiprazole, and so on. This is an algorithm for treatment of first episode psychosis, that is the first episode of schizophrenia. Trial of single antipsychotic. So second generation antipsychotics are mostly preferred. The atypical antipsychotics, you start with them, give them the optimum doses. First you give the lowest dose, lowest recommended dose. Then you wait for 2 weeks. Then you give the maximum or the optimized dose, the dose which is tolerated by the patient, that is the optimized dose. If you feel that is not working, you add a first generation, you either change the second generation or you add a first generation. If still there is no effect, then you add clozapine. I said third choice, right? If still that is not working, then you give a combination, first generation, second generation, maybe clozapine with ECT, right? So as I said, ECT is not the first line of treatment. First line is second generation, any of the second generation antipsychotic. Adverse effects, I will only name them. You don't need to go into how the adverse effect, what is the mechanism, what is the chemical mechanism of the adverse effects. You don't need to go into the details. What are the adverse effects of antipsychotics? And I tell you, adverse effects, they are more with the first generation than the second generation. Second generation antipsychotics, the atypical antipsychotics, they are better tolerated. Why? Because there are some side effects called extrapyramidal symptoms. You might have learned about that in your pharmacology. Extrapyramidal symptoms, that is symptoms produced by the extrapyramidal tract. What is extrapyramidal tract? Cut to your first year, refer your neuroanatomy. Okay, you should know about it. So adverse effects include sedation, autonomic side effects. What are autonomic side effects? Anticholinergic side effects. Why anticholinergic side effects? Because usually if you give first generation antipsychotic, you have to give an anticholinergic agent along with it. Why? To prevent the extrapyramidal side effect, to reduce the extrapyramidal side effects. Otherwise, it can cause a lot of tremors, rigidity, everything. Okay? To prevent that, we generally give anticholinergic agent like trihexyphenidyl along with it. Okay? So, anticholinergic side effects like dry mouth, constipation, blurred vision. Antipsychotics are not the drugs in which, unlike your other pharmacologic drugs you just mentioned, what are the side effects? Ma'am, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, constipation, these, that. You don't mention those side effects at the first go. Okay? Very specifically, if somebody asks you the side effects of antipsychotics, especially the first generation, the first things you should mention is extrapyramidal symptoms. That is tremors, rigidity, mask-like faces, the Parkinsonian symptoms. Okay? So again, the anticholinergic side effects are postural hypotension, palpitation, inhibition of ejaculation, photosensitivity, etc. Extrapyramidal side effects. What are they? Akathisia. Akathisia is inner feeling of restlessness. You feel very restless. The patient will not stand at one place. Will constantly keep moving his legs, constantly keeping moving his hands. Be very restless, move from one place to another place. Okay. It's not just the outer features that we see. There is an inner feeling of restlessness. The person continuously feels restless. Okay? That is akathisia. Dystonia. Tone of the muscles is abnormal. There could be tightening of the limbs, rigidity. Dystonia. Pseudo-Parkinsonism. It occurs due to the blockage of D2 receptors. Now, another homework for you, another question is for you is, what is the mechanism for neurobiological basis for Parkinsonism? It has something to do with dopamine in the basal ganglia. Read about it, find out what happens in Parkinsonism, and then think, what do the antipsychotics do? Antipsychotics are basically dopamine antagonist, meaning they would reduce the dopamine levels, right? Now this is for you, this is a homework for you, correlate how this happens and why in the side effect of anti-Parkinsonian drugs psychosis occurs. Okay, find this out, this is for you to read about. So pseudo-Parkinsonism, tardive dyskinesia is a syndrome characterized by abnormal involuntary movements occurring late in onset and in relation to initiation of antipsychotic drugs. Abnormal involuntary movements, and it is chronic. That's all for you to remember for tardive dyskinesia. Neuroleptic malignant syndrome, it is a syndrome on its own. It is a life-threatening condition. If not treated in time, it can be lethal. Okay, it is a rare but a very serious complication. Comprises of fever which does not touch the baseline. Diaphoresis, rigidity, confusion, fluctuating consciousness. Hyperthermia. Temperature which does not touch the baseline. Okay? It is different from malignant hyperthermia. Treatment for it is bromocriptine. This is important for your MCQ purpose. Bromocriptine is what? A dopamine agonist. So the entire dopamine mechanism, that is for you to find out what happens and why bromocriptine is also given in neuroleptic malignant syndrome. Others are hormonal effects, sexual dysfunction. Others, miscellaneous are weight gain, jaundice, photosensitivity. Okay? टू कंक्लूड आई थिंक वी हैव कवर्ड क्वाइट इन डिटेल. दिस प्रेजेंटेशन विल हेल्प यू गो थ्रू योर राइट अ प्रॉपर शॉर्ट नोट अबाउट इट. सो स्किज़ोफ्रेनिया, क्रोनिक कॉम्प्लेक्स डिसऑर्डर, द एपिडेमियोलॉजी ऑफ इट अकर्स इन 10 to 25 years and 25 to 35 in males and 25 to 35 in females with a bimodal presentation in females. The 4 A's given by Eugene Bleuler: association, affect, autism, ambivalence. The other epidemiological factors, etiology is chiefly genetic factors, but there are others also, the biochemical factors, all these neurotransmitters, the main being dopamine, followed by glutamate and then serotonin. Clinical features, positive symptoms, negative symptoms, cognitive deficits. Prognosis, poor. Recovery is possible, but the prognosis is poor. There is no known definite cure for schizophrenia. A medical history, a detailed history from the patient as well as the relative is very important. The psychiatric evaluation. Management, hospitalization, pharmacotherapy, psychotherapy, rehabilitation. Okay, these four titles should be included when you write about the treatment of management of schizophrenia. So when you are asked management, you start from diagnosis. Okay, and diagnosis starts from a good clinical history. When you are asked only treatment, or maybe if you are asked only pharmacotherapy, then you in pharmacotherapy you mention only about drugs. When you are asked about treatment, you can start with hospitalization. Okay, hospitalization, pharmacotherapy, psychosocial interventions, which include social skill training, individual therapy. This name is important. Social skills training, it is a very important aspect. You can Google it out if you are interested. Somebody is very interested, you can Google it out and know what it is. Family therapy, vocational rehabilitation. Rehabilitation word should also come. Electroconvulsive therapy, again very important. This is a brain stimulation method. If somebody asks you, brain stimulation method. Clinical management, antipsychotic drugs, first generation antipsychotics, which are the typical antipsychotics, they have more chances of extrapyramidal symptoms, briefly called EPS. Second generation antipsychotics, which are better tolerated. This is the chemical classification of first generation antipsychotics. These are the second generation antipsychotics, the treatment algorithm. Adverse effects, EPS should come first. EPS, then sedation, autonomic side effects, extrapyramidal side, which I said, which should come first. EPS includes akathisia, dystonia, pseudo-Parkinsonism, tardive dyskinesia. Okay, then there is neuroleptic malignant syndrome, hormonal effects, sexual effects, miscellaneous effects like weight gain, jaundice, photosensitivity. There is also something called hepatotoxicity. Rare, but you can mention. Okay, so to conclude, just one sentence. If you talk to God, you are praying. If God talks to you, my dear, that is schizophrenia. Okay, thank you very much. Our email ID, we had mentioned it. If you have any queries related to topic, if anyone wants to consult, this is our email ID. You can freely contact us. Okay.